Hello. Tell me if you can't hear me. I'm beginning with a personal story. I lay on the floor under the Stations of the Cross. I had come a day or two before to St. Bino's Spirituality Centre in North Wales, a place where for some years I found the benefit of silence, one daily conversation, and exercise in the garden and the hills around the Clwyd Valley, which Gerard Manley Hopkins immortalized in his poetry. And in a simple prayer room, I gazed up at the individual depictions of the last journey Jesus made as he willingly surrendered himself and became totally vulnerable, letting go of control. This year I discovered a new definition of suffering, that of Richard Rohr, who explains suffering as when we are not in control. I have put most of my quotes on the sheet that you've got, and you'll notice that's at the top. So hopefully you don't have to scribble down most of those quotes. They should be there. I had come there for a week's retreat at the end of a long and difficult experience of trying to reverse certain decisions involved with a project that had captured my heart for many years, and I had failed. Others were in control, and I was cast aside, suffering pain, not only, I trust, for myself, but for the loss of something beyond words which affected others as well as me. It takes time to reach the depths of our inner pain, and so this was probably 3 or 4 days into my time at Bino's. I had a Monday to a Monday, so that's 6 days of silent retreat. So around the middle, the right moment, as I had discerned with my spiritual guide that morning, to allow my pain to be joined to the passion of Jesus. This is our theme. So I simply followed the story on the wall and noticed how what he experienced touched my story so closely. There was the injustice of his being judged by Pilate. I had not managed to remain in silence in the injustice I experienced, though much good my shouting did me. There were the women meeting Jesus, Veronica and Mary, offering what they could. I too had known comforters on the road who were similarly helpless, but there. There too was Simon of Cyrene, shouldering the burden, offering relief on the way. I too had known strong characters who took my side and helped as much as they could to carry some of the weight. I was not completely alone. Others like Simon had labored with me and were similarly defeated. Poignantly, there was the stripping naked. Such a common experience in adversity, stripping both physically and psychologically by those who have power in that moment to tell you you're nobody now. And there was the shout as Jesus was nailed to the cross, the cry of abandonment, forsaken even by God. And I was aware of God figures, yes, bishops even, objects of negative as well as positive transference, who had forsaken me, either by their silence or some formula like, these things are always painful. Sorry about the voice. I didn't know I was going to do that. Apologies to any bishop known or unknown. And then there was, of course, the final moment of dying, the letting go. And I said to him, you were right. But you didn't hold on. You surrendered. And I saw very clearly all the valuable assets which I, with others, were letting go of. They'd already been ripped away. But now with Jesus, I was trying to surrender, to let go within myself. And the words of Matheson's hymn came to mind. You'll realize this evening that much of my theology comes through hymnody. I lay in dust, life's glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red life that shall endless be. Theology like that is all very well and very poetic, but if it is lived, it comes at a price, as it did for Jesus. He could not go through what he did without the bloody sweat of Gethsemane or the awful cry of dereliction, the loud shouts and tears to which the writer to the Hebrews alludes. So, at the end of sharing with Jesus something of my way of the cross, as it were, against and with his, I was left also with what I'd been reflecting on in Scripture in those days, the groaning of Psalms like Psalm 38. And at that moment, I found a deep and quite primal groan rising up, a sound as it emerged that might threaten to disturb the entire house, because it was becoming a scream. And there are not many places where you can safely scream without a fear that someone in a white coat will bundle you off to be sectioned. If I had another vision to fulfill, it might be to provide just such a safe screaming house. A place to release those prayers beyond words of which Paul speaks in Romans 8. Not only the groaning of the whole creation, but all of our inward groans, which only the Spirit understands, those sighs too deep for words. Fortunately, as I already knew, St. Bino's has such a place. Has anyone been there? I need to go. The next day I set off with a large key in my hand to the chapel on the rock, across the muddy cow field, to climb up the rock outcrop with the tiny chapel perched on top. A one-person chapel with glorious glass windows, no electric light. Somewhere I knew from previous visits where I could shout and scream as loudly as I needed. I don't think I have screamed for as long and as deeply as I did that day, or thumped the hard-wearing cushions of the seats, and that hurt. What was going on? Was I simply indulging in some self-actualizing exercise, a kind of narcissistic love-in with myself? There may have been some of that, for I am, in private, a bit of a drama queen. But I also know that the Spirit of Christ, who screamed from the cross, was at work in the hidden me, enabling that cry to be released and to be heard. And then I laughed with equal ferocity. I don't know if you can see from that personal introduction what I'm attempting to do this evening, which is to link in a quite deliberate way our pain with his pain. And I'm kind of taking that theme of the scream, our scream with his scream. Consciously coming at it, starting there from the end of my pain, because this is so often where we start. We don't need the events of Holy Week to tell us or remind us of suffering, or, as Richard Rohr put it, when we are not in control. I don't really like talking too long without a break, so can I invite you to have a personal moment in which to ask yourself, what is currently making you want to scream? I don't think we're going to have screaming in Walderslade. We could do that another time when we soundproof the building. It could be something personal. It may be something going on for someone you know and love. And as we think of Romans 8 and the groaning of creation itself, we could go as wide as we can. For we sometimes get over-entangled in our personal griefs and individual sorrows. So it could be the crucifixion of the environment. And maybe we need to read a bit of Gerard Manley Hopkins, The Trampling of the Earth. Generations have trod, and all is seared with trade and wears man's smudge and shares man's smell. Written at St. Vino's. It could be a tragic event or disaster. The struggles, maybe some of the recent horrors that we've witnessed. Coming from across the world. So think of a current groan, sigh, or scream, and then just take a moment to try and match it up with what is happening there with the Stations of the Cross. Sorry, I didn't bring them with me. I could have had them, couldn't I? But I'm sure you know them. The way of injustice, abuse, sheer pain, stripping, abandonment, surrender, and indeed violent, horrific death. Just notice how it feels to put those two together. If I'm interrupting your continued reflection, you could carry it on. You know, if it started something for you. And I'm not particularly going to invite discussion or feedback at this moment, but we will have a time later when we can buzz a bit and hold on to anything which may have struck you in that kind of exercise. So, what does this all tell us about God? When I, by setting my own pain in the context of Christ's pain, then feel enabled by his Spirit within my depths to scream, I have some questions like, what is happening for God? What is our theology of suffering? What is our theology of the suffering of Jesus on the cross? What is our answer to the question, does God suffer? You haven't walked out, okay? Stick with that. Let's start with our theology of suffering. Around the 1970s and 80s, when healing theology was at a kind of peak, partly as a result of the very immediate spirit at work edge of the fresh charismatic movement in the mainstream churches, there was a teaching around that we were not meant to suffer. And God always wanted us to be better. A simple but powerful and attractive view of healing from all pain. You can find that expounded in Francis McNutt's 1970s classic book called Healing. I ought to say, as an aside, I read this book on my honeymoon. Not quite sure why now. My wife was busy reading Poldark. In Healing, Francis McNutt countered the traditional Catholic argument about needing to bear your own cross and so on. In the 1980s, when I was then working at Burswood, which you may know, and sitting in on a discussion about a new workbook on healing, having looked through this workbook, kind of speed read it, I raised the issue of whether it contained any real theology of suffering. Someone who was a known and respected leader in the healing movement, distinctly replied, "There is no theology of suffering in the New Testament except suffering as a witness to Christ." Oh dear. Fortunately, since then, we've come a long way. The charismatic movement met its own reality moments, like the death of one of its leaders, David Watson, after earnest prayer and manifestations of warmth through his body when prayed for by John Wimber. And it was remembered that even Francis McNutt called death ultimate healing. So maybe we're coming back to so much of what the great spiritual writers have expressed, though Teresa of Lisieux is pushing it a bit far for most of us. In her words, "Suffering is his very best gift. He gives it only to his chosen friends." Now, you have to know the right moment to share that with someone in pain. We have to get beyond immediate agony to some kind of reflective phase to absorb that. Another strand of this is around the theology of the suffering of Jesus on the cross. What was going on when he suffered? Again, there has been, I'm not sure whether it is still around, that simplistic exchange idea. He took for us not only the burden, but also the reality of suffering, as well as sin. He suffered so we don't have to. He knew pain so we could be pain-free. It's there in Matthew, quoting Isaiah 53, Matthew 8, describing the healing work of Jesus. Matthew says, "This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. He took up our infirmities and carried our diseases." There may be those who bear witness to a spiritual experience in which they felt Christ take the whole burden of their pain and suffering, and they walked free. But of course, we all know that the different stages and experiences of life, especially when aging, introduce a much more complex process. I think I've come to view it more that there can be moments of great healing and relief, sort of moments of healing balm. But there are equally moments of great loss and grief. And all of these need to be encompassed in what God has done for us in Christ's death and resurrection. Then again, in the strikingly clear but often simplistic approach, there's a theology of the cross which is all about atonement for our sin. Jesus was carrying a burden of sin and offering a perfect sacrifice to God, which only he could do, and by this we are justified. We are justified in God's sight. Yes, but is that all the cross is about? Could it possibly be that on the cross, Jesus was not so much justifying sinful human beings to God as justifying God to them? And this is the area of theodicy. I think I've got a theodicy quote there. Yes, I have. The Oxford Dictionary of the Christian Church defines theodicy as defending the goodness of God in the face of the existence of evil. Dr. Frank Lake, who influenced me greatly when I was training for ordination at Nottingham in the 1970s, he was a psychiatrist who developed what he called clinical theology at the interface of psychology and theology, who came back from a time as a medical missionary in India to undertake clinical work with those seeking to integrate and come to terms with mental and emotional distress, what he diagnosed as early primal pain in their lives, groans too deep for words again. And in setting this within a faith context, He took up the theme of theodicy. How could those innocently afflicted come to the understanding that God was good, that God was on their side? Quote, "To give glory to God, the maker of a universe in which the innocent suffer lifelong mental pain, is hardly possible if this is all that is known about him. It is his self-revelation in Christ which alone makes a theodicy possible." So, Frank says, when we are faced with the crucifixion, now we know, he says, if we could not believe it before, that God is well aware what it is like to live in the world he has made. I wonder what you feel about this little crucifix. It's so little, I'm going to pass it round. I don't quite know how I got it. I think it turned up amongst the various items stored in my hospital cupboard in the vestry of our prayer room. And they had their origins in a number of hospital chaplains around Greenwich, where there are a lot of hospitals got closed, including the famed Brook Hospital. But there's no sense here. Just pass it round. There's no sense here that God is distant from Jesus on the cross. God stretches out his arms like Jesus on the cross, and within him we see the figure of Jesus also on the cross. So if you like, Jesus within, God stretching his arms out. And we can contrast that with the caricature, I know, of the substitutionary atonement theory, whereby an angry father punishes the world's sin by inflicting suffering on the son. Steve Chalk's vivid description of that as cosmic child abuse. Yes, a caricature, I'm sure. But this is nothing like that. Here the two are very close. And the great German Reformed theologian Moltmann can help us here. Writing The Crucified God, also in the 1970s, and no doubt closely influenced by German history, including his own time spent as a prisoner of war, the clue is in the title, God was crucified. God, he says, was stretching out his arms, just as that little crucifix depicts. Moltmann put it that following Cyril of Jerusalem, we can understand the Christ hanging on the cross as the outstretched God of the Trinity. On the cross, God stretched out his hands to embrace the ends of the earth. Notice again, we come back to the healing of the whole creation, the ends of the earth. Where's it got to, the little cross? Is it going around? Yeah, it's going around, okay. We just have a little buzz back on that. How did you feel about that? And where you're thinking about the cross has reached? We perhaps just talk to each other about that as the cross is going around for a minute to have a... I've shown this to one or two spiritual guides that I have. There's another one I do want to show it to, and I haven't got to him yet because I think he might know. But they say they've never seen one like it. And one of the things that strikes me about it is that the face of God, and in a sense the... what's the word I'm looking for? The deportment, the shape, is quite maternal. And it is worth reflecting, you know, you're getting quite a lot of, because I'm old, of the history of the theology of these things in the 20th century. I find it very hard to talk about the last century myself. our thinking and our theology does constantly change, partly in the light of things that happen to us. And it may help you to reflect on how your understanding of what's happening on the cross may have moved and may still be moving in another way. So, does God still suffer? Following on from Moltmann, if God, in some sense, died on the cross, it raises the long-worn question of the impassibility of God. This goes back much further than the 20th century, to the very early beginnings of theology. In Greek, this is called apatheia. And the traditional denial that God can have reactive emotions is, we think, due to early Greek influences. Greek thought denied the possibility of divine pleasure or pain. So God had, one of the ways of describing it is God had no parts or passions. Whereas, of course, Hebrew thought, so God, as we find him in the Old Testament, freely ascribed emotions to God. Someone's put it simply that we can't possibly have a God who has a nervous breakdown when he has to keep everything else together. And we need to preserve the sense that God remains unchangeable and rightly other, distinct from us. Otherwise, we also veer to that rather self-centered and subjective God as a friend I keep in my pocket kind of theology. Yet most, I think, would now agree that we need an accommodation of the unchangeable distance of God from human pain and pleasure with the crucified God we see revealed in Jesus and who therefore must feel. The hymn, I've got some hymn quotes on the back of the sheets. You have to go that way up to get them. The hymn that gets it right for me is Timothy Rees's God is Love hymn. And when human hearts are breaking under sorrow's iron rod, then they find the selfsame aching deep within the heart of God. And certainly the human Jesus has taken his capacity for tears back to the throne of God. Doesn't he still weep over the city? There are tears in heaven. If he ever lives to make intercession, aren't there still loud cries and tears there? Hebrews. And finally, we might even face the question, in some sense, is Christ still on the cross today? Protestant theology has been traditionally opposed to crucifixes because, as the argument goes, on Easter Day, the cross was empty, and that is how it has always remained. I can remember this being explained to me, by clear evangelical Protestant thinking. You don't put Jesus back on a cross where he's not there anymore. Don't put him there. But there is that remarkable verse in Paul's writings, which, however you address it, carries a sense of the ongoing afflictions of Christ. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 24, Paul says, I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, the church. That's New International Revised English Bible. For the sake of Christ's body, the church, I am completing what still remains for Christ to suffer in my own person. Dorothy Keren, the founder of Burswood, where healing ministry combined with clinical care works, as a mission statement put it, within the mystery of suffering and healing, Dorothy said of those who came to Burswood, "Many have received through his grace and living power wholeness and healing. Others have come and have been given grace to live with their disabilities. And indeed, to glorify God in their sicknesses and offer their suffering in unison with his, and it has been used towards the filling up of the cup." Filling up of the cup, I always take as a pretty clear link with Colossians 1, filling up the sufferings of Christ. So the connection is made not so much that Jesus is still on the cross, as that his cross is still experienced in our suffering. And in a sense, he still suffers. And I just want to share three examples which might illustrate that. And the first one, an Auschwitz survivor called Wiesel wrote a famous book called Night. And I'm quoting. "The SS hanged two Jewish men and a youth in front of the whole camp. The men died quickly, but the death throes of the youth lasted for half an hour. Where is God? Where is he?" someone asked behind me. As the youth still hung in the noose after a long time, I heard the man call again, "Where is God now?" And I heard a voice in myself answer, "Where is he? He is here. He is hanging there on the gallows." And a personal memory. The first HIV death which I was involved in was of a young man called Martin. And I spent time with Martin a day or two before his death, anointing him with oil. And I remember giving him a drink through a straw, which caused him to gasp. And as his tummy gurgled, he himself said, "Sounds pretty desperate, doesn't it?" I left him that day, carrying the mental image of his courage, humour, and frailty, and went away to a short retreat. While I was on retreat, I contemplated the crucifix in the centre of the convent chapel. And then I got the news, because I'd asked his partner to ring the convent if Martin died. Martin was dead. And as I went back into the chapel, Jesus on the cross very clearly became the Martin I had seen on his deathbed. Which leads me to that remarkable picture, it's on your sheet, in Jim Cotter's book. It's a bit little. Much of Jim Cotter's book, written in the 80s, is about HIV. And here, Christ embraces the sufferer with Kaposi's sarcoma, a horrid skin condition to which HIV-positive people are prone. But as you play with that picture, which one is Christ? Because as I sometimes see myself in the role of Jesus, offering comfort to someone in extreme suffering, I find then that it is as if I am holding Christ in the suffering. And thirdly, quite different. If you look on the back of the sheet now, turn it over. Sidney Carter's great song, written in 1964 about the anointing of Jesus' feet by Mary. I'm going to go through it. Does anyone know it? Oh, we could sing it. We might sing the last verse. said Judas to Mary, "Now what will you do with your ointment so rich and so rare?" "I'll pour it all over the feet of the Lord and I'll wipe it away with my hair," she said. "I'll wipe it away with my hair. O Mary, O think of the poor. This ointment, it could have been sold. And think of the blankets and think of the bread you could buy with the silver and gold," he said. "You could buy with the silver and gold. Tomorrow, I'll think of the poor." "Tomorrow," she said, "not today. For dearer than all of the poor in the world is my love who is going away," she said. "My love who is going away." Said Jesus to Mary, "Your love is so deep. Today you may do as you will. Tomorrow you say I am going away, but my body I leave with you still," he said. "My body I leave with you still. The poor of the world are my body," he said. "To the end of the world they shall be. The bread and the blankets you give to the poor, you'll know you have given to me," he said. "You'll know you have given to me. My body will hang from the cross of the world tomorrow," he said, "and today. And Martha and Mary will find me again and wash all the sorrow away," he said. "And wash all the sorrow away." My body will hang from the cross of the world. So my conclusions, though I haven't quite finished, are: Jesus suffered. He still suffers. God has heartache. We and our world suffer, but this is redeemable because we suffer in him. And in a mysterious way, he still suffers in us and the world. And even our suffering may fill up the cup of his sorrows. But having talked for quite a long time, I need to say that this subject is not something actually that you can ever put into words. And to quote, as someone already has done, applying this to the cross, the famous dancer Pavlova. She was once asked to explain a dance. And she replied, "If I could say it, I wouldn't have to dance it." And this is the same with Jesus and the cross. The cross had to be done rather than spoken about or explained in words. So what? How do we appropriate this message? So I'm going to try and make some, they're quite dense but succinct observations. I think I've got four. One, does it mean we can be countercultural in not avoiding pain, suffering, and sadness? If you like, it is okay not to be okay. Suffering might even be embraced. And there may also be that discovery that mysteriously the suffering can be used. In Dorothy Caron's words, used for the filling up of the cup. And that might be some kind of prayer. I still remember the cancer patient in great pain. And in the middle of the night, I often had those conversations with patients about pain, because pain is one of those all-embracing experiences, isn't it? You can't put your mind anywhere else but on the pain. So if she was going to use the pain, she had to use the pain. She couldn't deny it. And in the middle of the night, she found she could mysteriously commune and somehow join her pain with the current pain of the world, which she'd heard about on the news. Now, who understands the mystery or the benefit of that kind of use of pain? Appropriate sadness is something that too often we want to deny. Appropriate sadness is not to be medicated away or mistaken for depression, as in appropriate reactive grief. Indeed, the truth is that where the sadness is also where the joy is. Remember that where I started this evening, I laughed from deep within, having screamed out sadness, anger, and fear. The two got to the same depth. And so you need to go back to Khalil Gibran and that quote from the prophet. Your joy is your sorrow unmasked, and the selfsame well from which your laughter rises was oftentimes filled with your tears. And how else can it be? The deeper that sorrow carves into your being, the more joy you can contain. George Appleton put it, we can break our heart into the age-long heartbreak of Christ. Secondly, it means we can live with our own process of diminishment. For example, as we grow older or weaker, and as we face ultimate diminishment in death. Teilhard de Chardin, French Catholic priest of the last century, developed the idea of communion through diminishment. So he says, God must in some way or another make room for himself if he is finally to penetrate into us. The function of death is to provide the necessary entrance into our inmost selves. And then he's able to pray. Grant that I may recognize you under the species of each alien or hostile force that seems bent upon destroying or uprooting me. In all those dark moments, O God, grant that I may understand that it is you who are painfully parting the fibers of my being in order to bear me away within yourself. Teach me to treat my death as an act of communion. In our own society currently, we're acutely aware of the diminishment caused by dementia. And there, even in the crucifixion, which is our loss of our own thought processes, we can still, the title of John Swinton's book, live in the memories of God. Thirdly, it means that God is as much, or even more so, in a violent and tragic death as in a good death. There are good deaths where people die beautifully, surrounded by families, having said their goodbyes to everybody. And we say, wasn't that a beautiful death? As if that's where God is in a most precious sense, which we feel to be true, because it has a feel-good factor. But although we do not seek them, accidental, violent, wartime, premature deaths are perhaps more deeply infused with Christ's own violent, unjust, and premature dying. Can we extend this also to suicidal death? I once reflected with a friend whose daughter ended her own life, and she did this specifically in the place where she felt closest to God. That without being blasphemous, Jesus also decided to die when he did. His disciples said, don't go, don't go. You'll be killed. But he set his face, as Luke says, picking up the Isaiah reading we had this morning in church, set his face like a flint. So someone who decides to end their life can also join their death to Christ's. And fourthly, it means there are ways that we can appropriate this gift of Christ's suffering in ours. Or ours in his. And already there, you might have heard echoes of the prayer of humble access. So the Eucharist, above all, is such a place. Not just a theory, but a practice of allowing us entry into that wordless mystery, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. And listen to how Julian of Norwich described this as living in the wounded side of Jesus. This is her 10th revelation. With his face full of happiness, our Lord looked at his wounded side. I followed his glance, and he led my mind on from this wound into his side. There he revealed a lovely and delightful place, spacious enough for everyone who is going to be saved to rest there in peace and love. And the hymn, H.W. Baker's translation from Latin, Jesu, grant me this, I pray, ever in thy heart to stay, let me evermore abide, hidden in thy wounded side. So we've rambled around, but hopefully it all comes together as something like this. Our pain in Holy Week is forever joined to his. His scream, now in our scream, makes all the difference. And his ongoing, I am daring to say, his ongoing scream still enables our screams to be used, transformed, and redeemed, and even to bring us to the laughter of joyful resurrection. A last word from a hymn. But this is a hymn where you have to use the traditional form. Don't use those terribly helpful new inclusive hymn books. The hymn of Robert Bridges, Happy Are They That Love God. And the last verse. Then shall they know, they that love him, how all their pain is good. Thank you.